praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking up. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And come. about Mark here, because I got him as a captive audience. We met about 40 years ago. He tells me the first time you met me, you're at a party. And I like to goof around a lot. I don't know if you know me that about me, but have you ever seen these noses with the glasses and the big mustache and these, you know, masks? Well, I had one of these at this party, and I was goofing around, and I saw my face, and I was like teasing around. I take
a voice from the corner of the room, starts howling with laughter. And I turn, and here's Mark, and he is just splitting it, just having the, just hilarious. And he says, "You don't look any different with the mask off." And that was the beginning of such a good relationship and a good friendship. Mark is, I mean, if you haven't heard Mark's music, you need to check it out. It's on YouTube, and he markets things, and so... near and dear friend, and it's such a delight. This is actually the first time we've ever performed together on in any venue. Isn't that accurate? As far as we know, we played at something down at the coast, but I think we did separate sets. But I'm just elated. This is really thrilling for me. So yeah, what was it? You're gonna Wheatfields.
Wheatfields, yeah. You ready?
Looking out across a wheat field, bright and sunny afternoon, wondering about tomorrow, wondering if he's coming soon. In his word I found the answer, final scenes are coming on. Evil now is being revealed. Harvest time at last will come. He's been waiting long for people needing time to come around. Now the harvest of his people for God will soon be done. Some have walked the easy highway, low the moon, led by selfish dreams and motives, thinking their way must be right. Some have filled their lamps with oil, burning through the darkest night. Soon their feet will be rewarded, clothed in Jesus' robes of white. He's been waiting long for people needing time to come around. Now the harvest of his people for God will soon be
going to do this take three song. Do you know this take three song, Val? You know take three? I just thought if you wanted to, you'd come up and sing with us. You know? No? Okay.
Thy children, Father, are tried and betrayed. Distressed we are, yet we will not despair. We are cast down, we are sore afraid, pressed on every side, yet God is there. God is there. And yet the light of God shines through us. So man will know that the power is not our own. The Spirit so we know that the things we can see, the troubles all around us, they will soon be gone. We look beyond the things we know will be, the joy that is to come goes on and on. On and on. On and on.
Sorry, hi. Pastor Merrill, and I'm a little late. I have church up in White Salmon, and so I was racing back to be here, and I appreciate, Harvey, you asking me to be a part of this service, and so I want to welcome, maybe you should welcome me, welcome to this service for Stan McCluskey and the memory he has given to us. By the way, a question, is all this talent come from him?
So this was a family joke. I love jokes, so this part of it. So people would ask us kids, well, where did you guys get your music? And we'd say, well, we got it from Mom because Dad still has his. But that joke kind of backfired because when I had children, people would ask, where did your kids get their hair? And and so they'd say, well, we got it from Dad because Mom still has hers. So anyway, that's that story.
Thank you for sharing that. Well, we're here in memory of Stan McCluskey, and so I look forward to our time together. But let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, again, I thank you so much for the opportunity we have to celebrate this life. And Lord, we pray for this family and the comforting arms that you would wrap around them so that, and the memories we treasure and look forward to eternity, we thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray, amen.
There are a variety of people that weren't able to make it that wish they could. A couple were my sister Susan, her family, and my brother Ron and his family. Ron does a lot of research on lineages, all that kind of stuff, and what he wrote here will bring out of his talent to be incredibly thorough. So on the way here, Sarah's going, you sure we don't want to line out like 3/4 of that? But you know, part of it is my dealio is very fine print, so if you see me squinting, that's what's going on here. Anyway, here's the deal. John Stanley McCluskey was born on July 31, 1931, in Alameda, California. He was the son of George Melbourne McCluskey and Myrna Alice Moon McCluskey. He died at age 90 on July 5, 2022, at his home in Natchez, Washington. He is survived by his brother, Archie McCluskey, his sons, Ronald McCluskey, Harvey McCluskey, Edward McCluskey, his daughter Susan Fleming, and many grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Okay, his father made a living by driving into Los Angeles and buying used furniture. He would then truck the furniture to outlying communities and sell them at a profit. As a result, Dad learned the basics of making good business deals, and that was helpful throughout his life. He also learned how to tie down loads with knots like the trucker's knot. He handed that knowledge down to his children. During his youth, he lived in Glendale, California, and attended the North Hollywood Seventh-day Adventist Church. His parents were both members of that church when they were courting and got married. He was friends with the family of HMS Richards, who started the Voice of Prophecy radio program. He and his brother Richard even sang in a quartet with HMS Richards' sons, HMS Richards Jr. and Kenneth. But he reported that that didn't last long because they all sang bass. He was a bit of a daredevil and sometimes told his children how he'd stand on the seat of his bicycle while riding down hills in Glendale. Can you guys understand what I'm saying? Okay. He was also athletic, but he injured his knee while running and it bothered him the rest of his life. He graduated from Glendale Academy and then attended Walla Walla College, but he was not really motivated to study, so he left the school and started working for a farmer near Pendleton, Oregon, along with his friend Jerry Brooker. Luella Smith told her sister Betty that there were two good-looking guys working on that farm. So they took some time off from their studies at Walla Walla College, headed to Pendleton to visit them. Luella and Jerry did not develop a relationship, but John and Betty soon developed a serious relationship, and it was pretty serious for a very long time. I'm just teasing, but anyway. When the job in Pendleton ended, John and Jerry headed for the Tillamook Forest and were employed by a logging company. It was hard work, and when they heard that there was a dairy farm for sale in Tillamook, Oregon, they headed there to check it out. They were very interested in buying it, but the farmer soon caught on that they knew nothing about dairy farming and refused to sell it to them. Betty had taken nursing at Walla Walla College, but that was not something she was really interested in, so she soon dropped out of the school to try and enroll in a beautician school. During that time, there were frequent trips up the long, winding road through the Columbia Gorge to spend together with Betty. They soon became engaged and were married March 2, 1952 in the Walla Walla College Nursing School dorm in Portland, Oregon, but it was not that easy. The minister was not licensed in Oregon, so they had to travel across the river to Vancouver, Washington, had a second private ceremony in the car under the bridge in the car. Isn't that funny? Soon afterwards, while changing a tire on the side of the road at night, he was sideswiped by a car and was seriously injured. He was putting on chains in the snow here in Camas, and it was right up the road from that mill. You take a look right up the road, my dad was squatting down there putting chains on. A car came ripping up that road, caught him right in the haunch and knocked him clear up and over the trunk of his car, and it really mucked him up. He was messed up with that for a long time. He had to have surgery to repair a long, deep laceration in his buttocks. Despite that injury, he was soon drafted into the U.S. Army and had to report for duty at Fort Sam Houston in San Antonio, Texas. While there, their oldest son was born in the Fort Sam Hospital. His experiences in the Army made him go by his middle name the rest of his life. Stan was trained as a pharmacy tech and got his orders to go to Korea as soon as his training was done. Little family traveled together to San Francisco, where they said their goodbyes. Stan sailed on a ship to Korea. Betty and little Ronnie traveled from there to their parents' home and to her parents' home in Aleutianik, Alaska. It was a very tough time for Stan. Not only did he replace two other pharmacy techs, but he was on duty 24 hours a day. He was the only pharmacy tech for a very busy MASH unit on the front lines. He could hear gunfire and shelling 24 hours a day. Furthermore, he was a vegetarian and only had the only thing they did not have meat was the white rice. As a result, by the time he got home, he was covered with boils, and despite being 6'2½" tall, he only weighed 120 pounds. On the way home, he was put on a military ship. The crew needed help in the clinic and asked Stan to help, but they couldn't use him if he was in the Army. So for the trip home, he was enlisted in the U.S. Navy. The trauma of his experience affected him significantly, and he would rarely even mention his experiences there. As he now had a family, Stan was much more motivated to become a good provider. As he had experience with pharmacy work, he decided to become a pharmacist. But his previous experience at Walla Walla College came back to haunt him. He expected that when he left the school, nothing would be recorded on his transcript, but all of those incompletes were recorded as failing grades. As a result, he had to do some fast talking to actually be able to start school at Washington State University in Pullman, Washington. The dean of the School of Pharmacy finally agreed to accept him on the probational basis. However, he had to have all A's and B's to stay in school. Stan studied very hard and was able to finish 4 years in training in three. During the summers, he worked in Alaska. One summer, he worked for the Gildersleeve Logging Company, living on a floating logging camp. Another summer, he worked in a cinnabar mine where the end product was lead. Other times, he fished for salmon. During one summer there, their second son was born. That would be me. As he did not have a cradle for him, his first bed was the open drawer of a chest of drawers. When he finished pharmacy school, he got a phone call from the White Memorial Hospital in LA. They were looking for someone with the qualifications to start an in-hospital pharmacy. Stan had promised his wife that they'd never live in California, but they both recognized that this was a call that was not to be ignored. They soon ended up living in Monrovia, California. While there, one incident became a family legend. They both wanted to get a tan, so they headed off to the beach. Stan had been raised in Southern California, so he knew a good beach, but they had been tanned well then. Neither one of them had a tan, so they were so burned that they could barely get out of bed the next day. Not only that, but Betty had left a kettle, a pressure kettle, of eggs boiling on the stove, and they had exploded, covering the ceiling. So there's a big shellac of eggs all over the place, so that was a fun thing. They soon moved to a little house on Marengo Street in Los Angeles and then to Linwood, California. While on Marengo Street, their third son was born, and their daughter was born were living in Linwood. But while there, the Cuban Missile Crisis developed. All the friends of the family were either actively building bomb shelters or looking at plans to build them. The schools had duck and cover practices in class. About that time, Stan got a call from Honolulu to work in the pharmacy at the Adventist Hospital there, but he and Betty decided that they'd follow the advice of Ellen White to live in the country. So they decided to go live in the country. Stan found a small advertisement in a farm. I'd like to mention a thing that happened while he was working at the hospital. I was a little kid, and my dad was telling an experience about somebody at his business that was getting fired. And I was terrified because I thought people were shooting at the place my daddy worked. And so that was just kind of a little bit of a bit of the attitudes from LA, the gang. Well, that's as close as we got to gang violence. So anyway, Dad found a small advertisement in a pharmacy for sale in Tule Lake, California. This small community was just south of the Oregon border. It looked promising, and they investigated it. The fall of 1960, the family loaded a truck loaned from Betty's father. Stan drove the truck, Betty followed in their car. While driving through the Siskiyou Mountains, they hit a heavy snowfall. Stan soon discovered the windshield wipers on the truck didn't work, so he spent equal amounts of time swiping snow off the windshield with his bare hand and trying to get his hand warm. Finally got to the house they bought along with the pharmacy, and in the morning unloaded the truck. To do so, they had to dig a trail through 3 feet of snow that had fallen in that snowstorm. The house was right across the street from the high school county fairgrounds. They decided that was not the best location, soon moved to a small brick house out of town. About a year later, Stan bought 60 acres of farmland, with about 3 acres of that being a small house, large parking shed, potato shed, and small bunkhouse. First winter, Stan and Betty worked hard at the pharmacy, were very successful. But with that success came further stress. On Christmas Eve, when the store was closed, they had just over $2,000 in the till. The bank was closed, so they put the money under their mattress and spread a very nervous time until the bank opened December 26. That might not sound like much, but about 5 years later, Stan paid $2,000 cash for a brand new sports car. About 5 years later, another pharmacist moved to town. Stan had been very generous with the people in the area. When the farmers had a bad year, he let them run up large bills at the pharmacy. Stan felt bad when these people felt no loyalty and soon moved their business to the new pharmacy. His business plummeted. He soon realized he needed to close the business. Stan had always been enamored with the idea of farming, so he initially tried to farm the 60 acres he owned, but soon discovered that to make a living, one needed to farm larger tracts of land. He then leased over 1,200 acres of land in Doris, California. I think it was 3,000 is what he ended up with. I'm not sure. The family worked hard to farm that area for several years, but it came clear that there was no profitability in farming something you did not own. Stan then moved his family to Klamath Falls, Oregon, took a job as administrator and pharmacist of a nursing home there, worked there for several years. Stan had always been very musical. He sang several special music for church. During those years, Stan and three of his close friends formed a barbershop quartet. They were all in the healthcare industry. They were called they called the quartet the Medicords. Bob Graham, ophthalmologist, sang bass. Stan sang baritone. Eugene Crowell, Dennis, sang lead. Bonnie, can you raise your hand? Bonnie Jacobs, nurse, sang first tenor. Their music was thoroughly enjoyed by all who heard them. Yes, indeed. Thank you for that. Stan soon decided he could do better financially by owning his own nursing home, bought nursing homes in Central Point and in Lincoln City. But the call to farm was strong. Oh boy, was it ever. So Stan bought an orchard in Natchez, Washington. I got home from college. It's winter time. I go to this house Dad had just bought along with an orchard. I say, Dad, what do you got here? Oh, it's an orchard. Well, what you growing? Oh, apples and pears and cherries, and we got some nectarines. Oh, really? I said, which trees are which? He goes, I don't know. We'll just wait till spring and see what grows. And I'm going, oh, it just hit me, and that feeling never left. So, anyway, that was my fun with part of the fun of that. Anyway, so there Stan and Betty got a call to be missionaries in Haiti. Call was for Stan to be an administrator pharmacist of an Adventist hospital in Port-au-Prince in Haiti. Betty was thrilled with the call as she thought the call was Tahiti. Even after the misunderstanding had been cleared up, they still kind of a little bit of a goof there. Anyway. Okay, so anyway, they still decided to go, okay? So he was the ambulance driver as well as administrator and pharmacist. Betty served as a pharmacy assistant, worked for the Haiti Union as the Sabbath in the Sabbath school department. Stan and Betty had special protection while there, but they didn't know about it for some time. This is quite an amazing story right here. On their first night there, after getting their belongings through customs, so they're living in a house that's surrounded by a gate. It was late at night. They were to spend the night at the boys' dormitory next to the hospital. When they got to the school, the gate was barred by a chained gate. Stan had seen that other gates in the country had a chain, but the lock was not closed, so he went to test the chain. And he got frustrated because here it's locked, it's late at night, how do you find? He couldn't even speak the language, so it's like, how do you get in here? He got frustrated and he did this jobby. And he gave the jerk, heard something fall to the ground and the chain came free, allowing the gate to swing open. The noise alerted the boys in the dorm and many heads were hanging out the windows to watch them drive in. Many of the other staff in the hospital had been attacked in their homes, but Stan and Betty, despite being aware of the danger, never bothered Stan. Finally asked one of the hospital workers about it. So when he popped that chain, this lock, it broke, but it wasn't the link at the top that broke. It shattered every layer of that lock all the way down. And he was like, what? That's weird. So he's picking up all these pieces, puts them in the pocket. Next day he goes to the maintenance man. He goes, hey, you know, can I get a new lock? And take a look at that. He's kind of like, well, that's the weirdest thing. This fellow, he's going, he looks at it, it's a Yale lock. He goes, I've never seen that before. He sends it back to the Yale company. Yale looks at that and they go, this never happens. This is not a thing that's supposed to happen. I don't know what it is. What happened was they moved from this house to another house. The people that moved into the area where they had just moved away from, it was only about a week that this other family were there. In the middle of the night, thieves come in there, raid them. And my dad's going, whoa, what's the deal with that? He goes, we lived there for years and nobody touched us. And the person he's talking to, he goes, well, don't you know? He goes, I didn't know what. He goes, you're Samson. He's like, what are you talking about? He goes, nobody pops a lock like that. Nobody's going to mess with you. And that's the story. That's the story of Providence and how God protected this man. And it's quite remarkable. It really is. Okay, so he ended up being seriously ill. He had Epstein-Barr. They thought it was might have even been AIDS because he was so close to blood products in this hospital. He ended up spending about how much time in the hospital there in L.A.? About 6 months, wasn't it? Incredibly, incredibly ill. Thought he might die even, you know. So anyway, he finally gets they're offering him a medical retirement. But he was a stubborn kind of person. I don't know if you ever met Dad or not, but he was pretty stubborn. And so he found out that there was an opportunity to be a hospital administrator in Monument Valley, Utah. So he went there to be an administrator. He's terribly ill. He's like knuckles dragging coming into this new appointment. And when he gets there, he finds out, well, they not only needed an administrator, but they didn't have a pharmacist either. And so he ends up being an administrator and a pharmacist, being dreadfully weak. And so quite a deal. So that was that. They lived there for 5 years. First house they lived in was the same one John Wayne lived in while making many movies in the area. His dad was a large man. He got the nickname Big John Wayne. So anyway, Stan and Betty returned to their home. We're almost done here, by the way. Stan and Betty had returned to their home in Natchez, Washington, where they lived many happy years. When Stan got the internet, he started posting on military bulletin boards trying to find some of his old buddies from the military, but he never did. However, one day he got a phone call from Washington, D.C. The man asked if he'd really been in that unit. In the MASH unit in Korea, said he still had his discharge papers. He did send them off to the man. Got another call a few days later asking if he'd be willing to fly to D.C. and represent his unit. Seems that after the war, the MASH unit was decommissioned. The building housing its records had burned down. When the war in Afghanistan started up, they needed another MASH unit, decided to put that 48th unit back in service. Stan had just been in a car accident 2 weeks before, wasn't feeling well, but when the man offered a flying first class, he agreed. On arriving in Washington, D.C., he was met in the airport by a young man in a limousine. Young man said, I'm yours for the weekend, sir. Take you anywhere you want to go. So Stan was able to visit all the interesting places in our nation's capital. Then on Sunday, he was sworn back into the U.S. Navy for the day. He later said, I never saw so many generals pay so much attention to a private in my whole life. That was a very therapeutic for Stan. He started telling stories of his experiences in the military, and he included many of them in his biography. Stan was grief-stricken by the death of his wife, Betty, June 22, 2018. He grieved for her for the rest of his life. Throughout his life, Stan was very active in the church. He did everything from working with Pathfinders to being an elder. During his later years, he wrote extensively on Daniel, Revelation, had several articles published. We look forward to being reunited at the second coming of our Lord. So we're going to do show a video now.
just wanted to echo what Harp said. Glad you all could make it. Many that wish they could have come. And appreciate the participation on Facebook. That's a such a wonderful communication tool for us to have remembrances and connections. I wanted to just say a few extra words. I wasn't sure exactly how the obituary part would capture my dad. I tried to play a recorder and guitar at my mom's and had the same response. So, to me it's important when you have someone that lives 90 years to just try and briefly capture some things about him. Some of the things that he gifted us with. A strong work ethic. Incredible sacrifice. The high priority of Christian education. Great involvement in the church. Strong relationship with God. A sense of humor. I thought I'd just touch on the eras of decades that went by because they each have a different flavor. I would say that my two older brothers had a different experience with my dad than I did and then my sister, because my dad changed. And anybody that's been a parent, anybody that's lived on this earth a while, can look backwards, I'm sure, and see the change that happens in their own lives. So I'm going to start this through my eyes, but not meant to dominate that above everything else that's been said. The 60s, we have good friends from that era that are here, just close friends for life. My parents in this two-bedroom house, there was other houses they lived in Tule Lake, in this two-bedroom house, they're hosting cousins from Alaska that are going to Milo Academy, and they'd come stay with us in Thanksgiving and Christmas because they couldn't afford to fly home. They were incredibly generous with their time, their resources. A highlight from Doris, which is maybe a low light. I remember as a little kid going out in the fields and chasing cows that later I learned the neighbors had purposely let into our wheat fields, and that there was even threats of bad things happening to us kids if they tried to chase the cows out of these wheat fields. Our good friends the Prices were farming in a similar community, and just lots of interwoven memories from that period of time. We live 30 miles roughly from the Adventist Elementary School, and our participation in helping get kids to be able to ride there, it was like you could call it a bus system, but it was station wagon and other vehicles just to help out. Many, many participants in that. Memories of Dad and Mom prioritizing Sabbath and having four super active kids and trying to still make Sabbath meaningful. So we were out and about almost every Sabbath. And out and about in Tule Lake meant many, many trips to what's called the lava beds, caves, exploring. My mom was a bird watcher. Us kids were rock throwers, so that didn't blend really well, but it happened a lot. The 70s, moved to Klamath Falls. Interwoven with that prior decade and then the 70s, many, many trips to Milo Academy. Any of you that have gone there, you know there's super curvy roads. So I've emptied my stomach on many corner because we would drive pretty quick to get there on time or whatever it was, but all of us got carsick. As was already mentioned, my dad bridged into nursing homes. My sister and I, compared to my older siblings, ended up being pulled out of school in brief. We would take our homework with us, and we had a different connection with our parents because we're kind of camping in the back seat, and we got an earful of them talking about their stresses and stuff. And it actually was a lesson in life because I got a sense of some of the things they were trying to cope with and deal with, financial stress and all these things. There was a move to Medford towards the end of that, or actually it was in the early part of the 70s. I would say back in the Klamath Falls days, I want to allude back to the quartet, you know, they traveled quite a bit, so we got to go there. That nice little sports car that you saw, the Carmen Ghia, that seats two, but my sister and I were crammed into it to come to the quartet practices, so memories of that, and it heats up actually if you're the one that gets the back window seat, which is no seat, you're laying there supine, but nice memories. There was a lot of mountain climbing, friends, the Grahams and others, jogging to get in shape. And when you start counting the mountains that my parents were at the top of, including St. Helens before it blew, I know you climbed some of those, Bonnie, as well, but it includes Hood, Rainier, St. Helens, Mount Shasta, quite something during that period of time. Very active members, you know, leaders of the Pathfinders, lots of activity. During that close, I don't know the years exactly, but close to the transition of moving to Medford, there was a evangelist came to Klamath Falls, and I believe his name is Glenn Kuhn. His message was claiming promises in the Bible. He has books out there, ABCs of claiming promises or something like that, as I recall. Really touched my mom's heart, but it, I would say in a way the message wasn't what my dad wanted or met his needs, but at that same time, a dad poured himself into the Bible. He was raised an Adventist, he, you know, was an active Christian, but I would say that there was a transformation in him. So the dad that I continued to grow up with, I would just view him as a softer, gentler dad as that progressed in his life. I don't think it was brought up in the obituary. My dad's mom lived with us many, many of the years that we're covering here. So I should mention that, you know, prioritization of family and family relationships was also something he gifted us with. Interwoven with that same time frame was many trips skiing, highlights, just great memories going to Shasta Lake, water skiing, just amazing. During the transition, I believe it was somewhere, you heard about the farm challenges of wheat farming in Doris, somewhere between there, he got like a long 3 to 4 week stint of being a pharmacist in Reading, just kind of a bridge job to get to the next set of things he was going to do. Well, for the kids, we got to stay in a trailer at Shasta Lake. So it's like, yay! And he's just killing himself working, and we're just playing day in, day out, and nice deep sunburn that I'll pay for here one of these days, I'm sure. But it was amazing. I wasn't sure where to fit this in, but as I'm scrolling here, just some of the ideas to mention. I mentioned the idea of dad softening. I mean, he was a very heavy-handed disciplinarian, and I just, what helps me is to ponder it through the generation that he's from. And again, I had the benefit of seeing the softening side, but the way I wrote it down is, if Mom was New Testament, Dad was Old Testament, and include Revelation in that. Judgment's coming. Again, it was mentioned all the nursing home projects he went into. It should be mentioned that this dedication to Christian education included supporting my oldest brother and his wife substantially in college. Then Harvey was in college, then I hit college. And you can just imagine, anybody that's ever penciled down the cost of Christian education is like, don't write it down, because it's gotta be a God thing to pay for it. But he's desperately, that's his drive, essentially, and they helped many other people attend Christian education, financed many other kids as well. But ultimately, we moved to Lincoln City. Briefly, there was challenges, business challenges that made us move back to Medford. We don't have to get into that, but while we were in Lincoln City, those were high school to college years for me. We worked in his nursing homes, we being my sister, Harvey, and I, and did orderly work in nursing homes. And it was just a really good, again, back to the work ethic concept, it was just really good setting to be in. I remember residents there that when I went on through the rest of my training, I went to nursing, then went on to medical school. I remember residents and presentations that they had, and then the lights came on later in my training. It's like, oh, that's what they had. And it's just, it was just a good background to have. Through orchard work was mentioned, lots of jokes, but also just painful experiences of that. My mom was the softer one, we felt like, you know, in our corner, you might say, but my poor dad's killing himself trying to pay for everything. But when it came to cherry season, I mean, eventually we figured out which trees were which. We had like 40 feet tall cherry trees, you know, 40 years old, bearing tons of the best cherries you've ever had in your life. And that was the one thing we would sell on the roadside. So my mom is down manning a roadside stand, and it looked like a little outhouse. We would just tease her about it. But she would run a flag up, and us kids, all of us, not Ron, because he wasn't at home at that point, were all up there picking our hearts out, just like, there's the flag! And we'd run a pickup load of fresh cherries down. So from tree to persons eating them was often less than an hour. My mom was an excellent salesperson, and she would just tell them, anybody would stop there, she's like, try them, you'll buy them. But she was very aggravated when a few people would come, and I don't know if you know, but a pound of cherries is a fistful. A few would come and pick up a fistful and try them, and then buy a half a pound. So she was very frustrated with that. But they're the best cherries ever if you get a chance to get Yakima cherries. Part of the internal family dynamic is, deep down, instead of maybe the love for farming, was Dad deep down knew that's the way to get your kids to go through college. Make them pick pears in 110 degrees in August. If any of you know what persilla is, it's a fruit fly that creates a honey substance on top of these pears. And we all went to college. That was a good motivation. I was down in Loma Linda when my dad came back from Haiti sick. He didn't know what it was. And I remember taking him to the ER, and it was with this uncertainty, and he was very obstinate. That could have been a whole nother theme of like, I'm fine, you need to talk to Betty and see what's wrong with her. That was his stance on medical care. But the doctor looked at us and said, how long has he been yellow? I was like, And it's amazing, if you are around somebody, they can have a change of color that you may not notice. And we didn't get it. And here he's jaundiced. And again, I'll reference another time, but this is one of the times, being around my dad during the course of that illness, the skinny pic that you saw, that's how skinny he got again, after not being skinny, being more like my habitus. He was on death's door. At first, they thought it was a pancreatic tumor. Imaging didn't show that. Then, you know, AIDS was right there. It was right during that time frame. I was like, well, maybe it's AIDS. We don't know. He was an ambulance driver. Maybe he got stuck with something. Ultimately, the EB virus is what came out, but it was an EB virus. If it was EB virus, it's not just like mononucleosis. The guy had liver failure. We had a little guest house at our house, and he went and stayed there with my mom. My mom provided lots of babysitting. Our two oldest kids had lots of grandma time, which was amazing. But my dad would sleep sometimes as long as 23 hours out of 24. And I look back at it, and I was like, how did we let that happen? But really, when all the discussions took place, the actual summary was, seemingly, he was sent home to die. He asked me, as he was, you know, his later years, he was doing quite a bit of writing. And he asked me, he said, the same flavor. It's like, why did you guys let me do that? Well, you've heard the flavoring. My dad has a mind of his own, had a mind of his own. So he was not going to go back to that hospital. He didn't curse, but you could imagine the flavor of that blankety-blank hospital. I'm not going back there. So that was quite a sobering time. I saw my dad nearly cry with the fear of death staring at him. And touched my heart. When they went back to Natchez, I mean, there's lots of intervening stories. I don't want to prolong all this, but while they were in Haiti, the person that had bought the orchard from them actually neglected the fruit trees. So you had about 40 acres of fruit trees. If you don't spray your fruit trees, they become a nesting ground for all kinds of insects. And your neighbors are not going to be happy with you because it will infest their trees. So by order, they had to have all their trees cut down. So when I go back, when I went back recently to visit, it's just heartbreaking to see just, you know, weeds where there used to be these gorgeous, wonderful producing fruit trees. But they went back up there. There's a blend of about almost 20 years that was a lot of challenge, angst, and pain as they're back up there. My mom started losing functionality mentally. She had a dementia. Alzheimer's is thrown out there, but unless you actually have a biopsy or something, you can't diagnose Alzheimer's. But that was the flavor of it. If you've ever been around a loved one that has had that, it was just heartbreaking. And my dad provided a great deal of care. My sister, Susan, provided a great deal of care during those many, many years. And it was just challenging. You'd see the dynamic of us kids trying to make decisions, trying to help. And my dad was super private, including with his finances. It's like we couldn't figure out, you know, what are the resources? What are we doing? And I would just say it was a very painful time. I ran a pain clinic in Portland. And we ran up against an abrupt financial crisis. There's a management situation where taxes, income taxes, payroll taxes, the way I should say it, were not being paid. And we suddenly get this notice from the IRS, like, oh, this is really, really serious. So again, for me, the relationship I had with my dad, that he was my go-to for that crisis, and he came. So here, I don't remember how mom's condition was at that point. Wasn't as serious as it became, but he came down and helped. And he poured himself into it. And there were many nights where he and I were argumentative about what's the next best step, trying to save this, basically save our future, but he's doing it on our behalf. Sometimes we'd be arguing, and then finally either one of us or the other would realize that we're arguing about tomorrow versus the other person's thinking of in a month. And it's like, we actually agree. Let's just leave it at that. We didn't always agree. He had a powerful mind. He was a great manager person. But being a great manager person, I do have to go back to a little bit back in time, because it reminds me of a story Harv and I have a good laugh about a lot. We got assigned to do a lot of stuff, because during the orchard days before they went to Haiti, he was still working as a pharmacist in the hospital. And so he would assign us to do stuff, and included like taking the lobsters or whatever crawfish out of the sprinkler systems, digging this trench or this trench. So we go out to where there's a spring, and the assignment is, well, there's a leak by the spring, and the spring fed the sprinkler system. You need to dig that up and fix it. So we're out there digging, and it's like, well, basically it was rotted cement piping. And so we're digging with shovels, the greatest tool ever when it's a huge project, like from here to somewhere in the parking lot. And we did it for about a week, I think. Again, over 100 degrees. And we finally get Dad, because he's scolding us for not doing it. You know, come on, let's get that project done so we can move on. And finally get him out there and point out, by the way, the water's springing up here, 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 here. And this quick, he was like, well, we need a backhoe. I was like, well, thanks, Dad. No credit, you know, up until that point. But funny, but also painful memory. Because it's not alone in its nature. So a couple things about his interface with medicine. A lot of medical people in the family. So we tried to make sure there was a sense of what do you want at the end of life? It's a really important concept to figure out. He got really sick with gallstone pancreatitis. That's where the gallstones obstruct your pancreas. And can cause a lot of inflammation, because everything your pancreas makes can inflame all of your internal organs, really, in the abdomen. So he goes in. It took us probably a day or two for family together, and he was seriously ill. We were worried possibly he wasn't going to make it. But again, at that time, he was an obese man, probably had sleep apnea, but always denied that he did. So we get there, and I was like, he needs to be intubated. Needs to be on a ventilator. And the doctor that was taking care of him said, no, I looked at it, I talked to him face to face, and no, he absolutely doesn't want to be on a ventilator. And, you know, there's, again, this medical family certainly would normally accept that if it was end of life, but it's like, this is treatable, and kind of need to support the guy during this period of time. When he got better, fortunately he got better from that, but when I explained it to him that it was likely going to be a transient episode, then it was, of course I would have wanted that. As time went on, after that episode, he needed a pacemaker because he was so bradycardic. I got the privilege, it was a rare privilege, to be able to sit in a doctor's visit with my dad. It was never really a welcome thing to have us, because we might interfere with his messaging to his own doctor. So I'm sitting there, and the gentleman that comes in said, the doctor that came in said, so are you an athlete? And I'm just waiting for the ba-da-bum, because it's like, yeah, right. And my dad starts, well, I used to climb mountains. And then they asked him, you know, kept talking, and I'm just waiting for this, like, can we get to the point? He needs a pacemaker, folks. And he went on, and, well, how much do you walk? And I said, oh, several miles. And so we get out of the parking lot. I mean, he got away with all of that messaging, except for me at the very end, just stating outright, you're going to put in a pacemaker, right? That's how I teased him. It was like, when he asked how far you walked, he meant in a day, not in a year. So quite a dilemma with all that. At the very end, I should say, we all got together. You saw some of the pictures, and thankfully, we got together for his 90th. That means a lot to us. It meant a lot to him. At the very end, it was very painful. He was in a nursing home. The angst of trying to meet someone's expectation that's in that situation, just very, very hard. And even though he was intact and could make his own decisions, I would say his judgment was challenged for what most people would have chosen. One of the times he was like, I just need you to help me buy a car because I'm going to drive to Georgia where Susan is. And again, this is a 90-year-old man that's in a nursing home because he fell and has congestive heart failure. I was like, Dad, let's work on your health first. So last thing, the good thing, and again, it's more about me, and yet it was for him too. I talked to him, I think it was probably 2 days before he died. And that means a lot to me. The rest of us have shared how much we were robbed from never getting to say goodbye to Mom. So last thing. I deal with life and death all the time. I'm an ICU doctor. And I see the angst in families, some of it mirrored with our own family, frankly, tearing down relationships because of the stress of the challenges of the moment. But there are those that have no hope. That's most of us, at least. That's what we have.
Yes. Thank you, Ed, for those memories. And what an amazing life, huh? You know, I just want to share quickly that hope that we have, Ed. You know, in the Middle East, sheep are not, they're not driven. You know, in most countries we see sheepdogs or shepherds behind the sheep, you know, herding them along. In the Middle East, the shepherds call to their sheep and the sheep follow them. In fact, in some places their water is very scarce in the Middle East, and so oftentimes, shepherds will bring their flocks, several shepherds will bring their flocks at the same time to the same watering well and pull the water out. And all you see is a mass confusion of sheep. And you wonder, how in the world are they going to sort whose sheep is who? But the shepherd, all he does when he's ready to leave and he feels like his sheep have drank enough, he calls. And the sheep hear his voice, and out of that mass confusion comes his sheep, and they follow him. Jesus said these words, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, and no one can snatch them out of my hand." I just thought of that resurrection day, Ed, in 1 Thessalonians 4. Where Paul writes this, he says, "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep or to grieve like the rest of them of who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own words, we tell you that we who are still alive and who are left till the coming of the Lord will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And after that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so will we be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. So no matter if we're living or we're asleep, we will hear his voice and we will be gathered together with him. You know, we've had Darby so much good memories. If you don't mind, I think it would be nice to have a few more. If anyone would like to share some good memories that they have with the family, with this family, please, we have mics here we can share. Anyone would like to share? Just state your name and for my sake.
Well, my name's Bonnie, and I guess those years at Klamath Falls were the best of my life. When I first moved to Klamath Falls, somehow they got the drift that I did some singing, and they had just lost their tenor. So the quartet, it was a trio at that point, asked me to sing with them in the metachords. And so I sang tenor. Oh, it was at least 8 years. And we had a ball. And I won't take all of your time, but just know that we laughed a lot. We climbed Shasta a lot. We actually sang one time up at Castle Craigs. We were on a camping, skiing trip together, and we went to where the river flows through that area, and we went up to on a hike to Castle Craigs, and we found this wonderful little niche, and the music bounced off the big rocks all over, we were surrounded with. And it gives me goosebumps right now. Okay, so I'll tell you a funny story. So the quartet went in gathering every year, and either Betty or Eileen would go to the door and knock and talk. And there we were. Okay, now I'm in trouble. And there we were, singing in the background, and we were enjoying it very much, and it was a crispy, snowy time, and all four of us spied these pumpkins on their on the doorstep that had been there since Halloween, and we're talking December. Okay, so if you've ever seen a pumpkin, what it does after it's been frozen over and over, the smile just kind of...
It's scary, isn't it?
Sinks down. Everything sunk down. And we got the giggles. And I'm telling you, we had to stop singing. We could not sing. We just got the giggles. And here's these, you know, supposedly professional older people. Well, except for me. And we lost it completely. I don't know if we ever got it back together that night. But we sure tried. But anyway, we just had grand and glorious times. At home in our church, traveling around singing. Okay, so we were the first quartet with somebody who wore a skirt. Let's see, every year all the quartets would come to Klamath Falls for a regional it was a competition, but then they all sang together too. And we were the opening, what do you call it? We were breaking the ice.
Opening so, act, huh?
Yes, yes. And they couldn't compete because they weren't four men. Mm-hmm. So I often say I finally proved it, you know, I had the baby. but anyway, so we got up there and we sang Bill Grogan's Goat. And Eileen had taken four mops and cut them like, you know, with bangs and straight up, and dyed them black, and we were the Beatles. Oh. So it was Bill Grogan's Goat, yeah, yeah, yeah. And on, yeah, 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 you know, the whole thing. And it brought the house down, and we kind of had trouble singing it because we almost broke out laughing. But anyway, we had a really good time at that, and then they invited me up when they sang the finale. And that was a first. I don't know if that's happened in other places, but it did for us. And so we just had loads of experiences. I think you could write a book.
Amen.
Wish my memory would remember it all, but I pick up a few things now and then. Thank
Very
you.
Good. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else?
I'll try.
Okay.
And he's got me crying too.
That's okay. It's okay. We can laugh and cry at the same time. Like.
Well, we met McCluskeys when they came to Tule Lake. And Susan was 8 months old. We had a lot of fun with them. I babysat the kids. I had their 4 and my 4. And
you poor thing.
My son tells the story about the kids were running. Susan came around one corner of the house, Bruce came around the other, and they hit head on. And Susan looked a mess the next day. Betty took her to the doctor to make sure she wasn't mortally wounded or something. And Betty was so generous. She loved books. And poor Stan, I'm sure, had to pay for all these, but we would go to camp meeting and she'd say, okay, these for me, these for my friends, and she would have 2 great big stacks of books. And one time Betty and I went to Milo and picked blackberries, and it was in a cow pasture. And we had a great big buckets of blackberries already picked, and we'd go down the line trying to pick some more, and we looked back, and here the cows were eating our blackberries. And Betty was so afraid of the cows, she wouldn't do anything about it. And I'm not letting those, that's too much work. I'm not letting those guys eat my blackberries. So I chased the cows away. And we were poor farmers, and believe me, we were poor. And so she would get us a cabin at camp meeting. And she and I'd go up there early, and then Stan and Roy would come along later when they got off work. And so she was just a very generous heart. Like I say, I'm sure Stan had to pay for all this. Oh, one other memory she was laughing about. It was Stan's birthday, and she gave him a birthday present. He unwrapped it, and it was a bathing suit for Betty. that's what I can think of. Yeah. Huh? Yeah, my kids lived with them when they were in Klamath Falls and went to school.
Dorothy would drive us to school.
Yeah, she would.
Yeah, pilot, the more the merrier.
That's what I can think of at the moment. Here.
When they moved to Tule Lake, I was a farmer, dirty most of the time. So anyway, I got off early one night and went over and helped them unload the truck. And I helped them unload the truck, and Betty kept worrying about me being so tired and everything. And I felt pretty good, young man, back then. And then when I got home, I realized I had a half acre of dirt on my face. No wonder she felt sorry for me.
My name is Lester, and I guess I'll go ahead and share my little bit about Stan. First time I met Stan was actually at Milo. I went to school with some of the boys here and even graduated with one. And I met Stan a few times. And then, you know, over the years, you lose track of people. And we moved to Selah, Washington. And I remember the first Sabbath we were at Selah Church. And I didn't recognize Stan, but Stan, for some reason, did recognize me, and he came up to me and shook my hand and said, "You went to school with my boys."
Oh.
And it started a new friendship with Stan and I. Once in a while, I would be asked to speak. After I'd spoken, he and I would have a discourse by email back and forth. This is back in the days before Facebook and Messenger, all that stuff. We'd just email back and forth. And then my daughter got to know him when she spent one summer working for BibleInfo.com. And I guess he was one of their people that they could send questions to. And it was something that Stan loved, was answering people's Bible questions for them.
Yeah.
And he would spend a lot of time doing that. And I remember once or twice, he actually didn't forward the question to me, but looking back now and talking to him later, he would forward some of the questions to me, run them by me before he actually responded. He was kind of using me as a bouncing board a little bit. But you know, things happen over time, and we didn't get to see Stan as much. My last time I saw Stan was at that nursing home. I thank God for the person that was on that night. We arrived at the door because it was during the middle of COVID. And as we got to the door, we got in and the lady said who we were there to see. And we said we were there to see Stan McCluskey. She said, "Oh, we can't let you in. You have to have an appointment first." And we were kind of down. But this guy who we learned later was the administrator came out and said, "John's in a room by himself. We'll take you in." And the smile on Stan's face was worth it.
Amen.
I'll never forget that day. I want to go back and see him more, but things just never, because of COVID and everything else, that just never worked out. You know, either I felt I'd been exposed or didn't know or whatever. You know, you were just careful during that time. But I thank God for Stan. And I thank God for all the times he and I were able to bounce biblical things back and forth. Mm-hmm. I still have some of his emails last I looked.
Man. Thank you. I just want to share, it's beautiful, Harvey, to have these good memories and to laugh and to, what the joy is that Jesus has provided these memories can, we can make memories throughout eternity. We just may have to be separated just a short time, but Jesus has promised that he has eternity and we can continue in our quartets. Maybe in-gathering will be done, but everything else will be there to make memories, so we can enjoy that. And so I think, Harvey, you have some music? Yeah, go ahead.
So I was trying to think of what I do to kind of highlight my dad. And I was thinking about a lot of stuff about what my dad was about. And I started thinking, you know, one of the things my dad loved to do more than anything was drive. He looked happy, looked content, looked like pressure was off. In fact, his mind would wander. And so we used to, around Christmas time, love to go see Christmas lights. So we go around blocks and, you know, all around the city looking at Christmas lights. Well, one time we brought Ron home from Milo and it was nowhere near Christmas. But my dad was driving, we were driving home from church and all his kids are hungry. Dad's mind's wandering and he turns off the path and he's wandering through the neighborhood and he's just, you know, thinking about things. We're going, "Well, what's going on, Dad?" And Dad catches on that he's not tracking and he's going, "Oh, I was just looking for Christmas lights." And so that ended up being a his little ha-ha dad joke, because anytime he wanted to tease us, we're in a hurry, we're hungry, dad would go looking for Christmas lights with a load of kids. So anyway, that was my dad. So dad loved to drive cars, loved to drive planes, boats, airplanes. He loved to drive tractors, and he loved to drive his kids crazy. And so this is a song called Country Roads. Not very typical, maybe, and I'll just pick along with his laugh. Anyway.
West Virginia, the huge mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is older than the trees,
younger than the mountains,
moving like a breeze. Crossroads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia,
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
And we'll do this in Steve.
not deep.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father, we will offer a tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, again, we are thankful for the life of Stan McCluskey that has touched each of us. I pray that you will bless this family and wrap your comforting arms around them, and look forward to the hope that we have in Jesus. And one day we'll live eternally with you and be as one unbroken family. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.